While attending an ASML presentation at SEMICON Korea, I noticed a tidbit on one of the slides. A key part of ASML's future EUV roadmap has been growing the power source to 800 watts or more. But it had not been super clear to me how they were going to do that, other than maybe raising the speed of the tin pellets. Then I saw the slide and it showed something new, at least to me. 3 laser pulses rather than 2. Now, how about that? No, this is not an Onion article. This looks to be real. In this video, I want to talk about lasers and EUV light sources and how 3 is better than 2. But first, I want to remind you about the Asianometry Patreon. Early access members get to see new videos first with selected references attached. I'm working hard to organize and annotate these references to make them more useful. Early access really helps a lot and is one of the best ways to support the channel. I know times are a little tough, so I deeply appreciate all of you. Thank you, and on with the show. The 13.5 nanometer EUV photon has about 92 electron volts of energy. This is a lot of energy. Your typical garden variety visible light photon has between 1.5 and 3 electron volts. Emitting such a photon requires that we excite an atom to a higher state. When the atom relaxes, it emits the photon we want. The gap between those energized and relaxed energy states must be 92 electron volts. Producing such a big gap requires no ordinary atom. We need a highly ionized atom, meaning an atom stripped of several of its outer electrons. These inner electrons orbit much closer to the nucleus and so feel a much stronger pull from it. This allows them to make much higher energy transitions than outer shell electrons can. The tin atom has an atomic number of 50, meaning that a neutral tin atom has 50 electrons orbiting it. To start producing EUV photons, we need tin ions with 8 to 12 electrons removed, and we need a high proportion of those tin ions, which by definition is a plasma. This spot of energized plasma emits the EUV light that we so desire. In a 2024 presentation, ASML introduced an equation discussing how they approached the task of raising the EUV light source's power. The equation has several components. First, how much CO2 laser power can we deliver to the tin droplets? In the case of an LPP system, this is the product of the drive laser's power as well as the tin droplet repetition rate, meaning how many tens of thousands of droplets handled per second. Second, how effectively can we convert that CO2 power into useful EUV light? This is known as conversion efficiency, or CE. It measured how much in-band UV light is emitted and collected by the tin plasma light source for the amount of power going into the system. Power is expensive, and conversion efficiency ties directly to the tool's cost of ownership. ASML's former CTO, Martin Vandenbrink, puts it excellently into context in Mark Hayink's excellent book, Focus. And he says, "It starts with 1.5 megawatts from the grid that yields 30 kilowatts in the laser, and that creates 100 watts of EUV light. Of this, about 1 watt ends up on the wafer. So a little bit of conversion efficiency goes a long way." There are a few other things to consider. How much EUV light is lost between where it is generated and when it enters the rest of the scanner system, that is called transmission, as well as how well we can maintain a stable power level. Optimizing those other factors does yield gains, and the stuff is pretty interesting. But for this video, we will focus on the first two components, power on droplet and conversion efficiency. One last thing, a good EUV light source must also produce as little debris as possible. Hitting the tin with the CO2 laser generates debris in the form of small pieces of actual tin or fast-moving tin ions. The debris can damage the multilayer optics and limit their lifetime. So, debris generation is a game-breaking issue. In a prior video, I discussed a major LPP light source alternative called laser-induced discharge plasma, or LDP. Since I covered this before, what follows is a summary. LDP evolved from another system known as DPP and essentially involves spinning two wheels in a vat of molten tin and sparking it with a lightning strike. The issue with LDP is scaling the power. Getting more light with this particular setup meant spinning the wheel even faster. But the wheel spun so fast, it splattered the molten tin everywhere. The amount of debris was insane. It's for this reason that the LPP liquid tin droplet is only 30 micrometers large. We want them to be as small as possible to better control them and minimize how much debris they generate. Now that we're all on the same ground, let us talk a bit about how ASML got to the two-pulse LPP sequence. The first LPP devices had tin droplets being hit by a single high-intensity CO2 laser about 50,000 times a second. At that rate, the droplet travels at between 130 to 260 miles per hour, which is 5 to 10 times the cruising airspeed velocity of an unladen European swallow. Early concerns about LPP was how to hit such a fast-moving droplet with a laser. In an attempt to solve this issue, in the late 2000s, ASML worked on an architecture called No Master Oscillator, or Nommo. Nommo is ingenious, but to understand why, we need to briefly talk about how a laser works. Inside a simple laser, we have two mirrors facing one another, one fully reflective and the other partially so. This is our laser cavity. Inside the cavity, laser light is produced by a gain medium, bouncing back and forth between the two mirrors until it gets strong enough to maybe burst through one of the mirrors to fire at a target. Nommo replaces one of the mirrors inside the laser with the traveling droplet itself. So as the droplet travels through the laser cavity, its own reflectiveness helps build up laser power until it enters a particular zone. Soon as it does, the laser is ready and thus fires automatically. Nommo was self-timing, removing the need to precisely track the droplet's location and then sync the laser pulse to that location. So it's diabolically elegant and clever. It also did not work. As Vandenbrink said in Focus, the tin droplets moved so fast that the light bouncing back and forth did not have enough time to build up gain, even with light moving at the speed of light. There was also a lot of tin debris gathering inside the cavity that they could not fix. By late 2010, the NXE3100 Nommo-based light source produced just about 10 watts of power. Realizing Nommo's limitations were fundamental, ASML and their laser supplier Cymer went back to square one. They created a tool called a master oscillator that generated a seed laser pulse, a single well-defined pulse that can then be amplified to high power before being sent out to hit the droplet. They called it MOPA. MOPA did the job, so now ASML has a power laser pulse hitting this single droplet, putting lots of power onto it, only to discover that the conversion efficiency struggled to rise above 1%. What's going on here? It becomes apparent thus that the spherical droplet is too dense. Light emitted by the plasma after being hit by the laser gets reabsorbed before it ever reaches the collector. There were other issues. You needed a very powerful laser to hit and ignite such a small droplet, but a laser that powerful also risks drilling a hole through the droplet or blasting it backwards before it can absorb enough energy to completely turn into plasma. Or even worse, the tip of the CO2 laser might turn the droplet's surface into a thick, ultra-dense plasma that reflects away the rest of the pulse. A great deal of laser energy is lost via reflection before it can make plasma and UV light. Or worse yet, the laser's light reflects back at itself, meaning the laser's own equipment, just like the Mirror Force trap card from Yu-Gi-Oh! There's the potential for immense budget-busting damage. It soon became clear to ASML and Cymer that they had to reshape the droplet before the main blast. The droplet needed to be flattened and expanded somehow. Thus, they added the pre-pulse to the MOPA. When the pre-pulse hits the droplet, it rapidly vaporizes some of the material on its surface. This is called ablation. The pressure resulting from this ablation flattens and deforms the droplet into a disc, widening from 30 micrometers to 500 micrometers. The target disc might just be a few nanometers thick at the center. A nanosecond or so later, the main pulse arrives, heating the disc and creating the EUV light plasma. The first NXE3100 MOPA plus pre-pulse systems arrived in 2013 and demonstrated power levels of 50 watts, a big jump from the prior Nommo and even MOPA systems. A year later, the NX3300 added another round of power amplification to the pulse laser. This allowed EUV light output to soar to 80 and then 100 watts. EUV wafer fabrication numbers started to accelerate, signaling that EUV had finally broken through. So what are our levers to scale up this power source for the future? There are not a lot of them. One way to do this is to increase the amount of CO2 laser power that we can bring onto the droplet. And as I mentioned, this is a function of both the CO2 laser's power and the repetition rate of the droplets. So we raise one or the other. ASML is working on extracting more gain from the CO2 drive laser, presumably by cutting down energy loss by the pulses as they travel to the EUV light source. ASML is also increasing the droplet velocity from 50,000 to 62,000 droplets per second. With these changes, ASML reported that they were able to increase total CO2 power on droplet by about 18%. However, we are limited in how many tin droplets we can send through the chamber due to a plasma wind effect. When a droplet turns into plasma, it creates a small wind, like a fart. So if the droplets are too close to one another, then the plasma winds farting out of the preceding droplet impedes the droplet coming after it. Progress continues, of course, but this shows that our ways of increasing CO2 power on droplet are somewhat limited. So the other lever to pull is to improve the conversion efficiency. But what can we do to do that? As with everything in life, the answer involves lasers. So the slide that ASML showed us earlier names the three pulses in its new EUV sequence. Two of those we already discussed. First, there's a prepulse. We already know what this is doing, flattening and expanding the liquid tin droplet. At the end, we have the third main pulse. This is the powerful 10 micrometer CO2 pulse that irradiates the target and produces the plasma and finally UV light. Nothing different with these two. But what is this middle pulse? ASML calls this the rarefaction pulse. To rarefy something means to reduce its density. So the goal of this pulse is to rarefy the tin disc, significantly lowering its density in preparation for the main pulse. The literature seems to imply that, if all goes right, after this rarefaction pulse you end up with a lower density pre-plasma plume, mostly made up of preheated tin atoms, individuals or clumps of them. With a solid disk, some of the main pulse's energy is still reflected away. But this plume structure is perfect for having the most tin atoms absorb the main pulse's energy, so to ionize them and emit EUV light, and to have that emitted EUV light escape to the collector with minimal reabsorption, thus resulting in higher conversion efficiency and more EUV light than with just disks. Such a pulse probably uses the same amount of energy as the first prepulse. The ASML slide says that the first two pulses are the same wavelength, 1 micrometer, but maybe shorter in order to better ionize the material and preheat the disk. Pulling off the three-pulse sequence will require more than simply hitting the thing three times, most crucially timing. You can't hit the pre-plasma plume immediately after the second pulse. It needs time to disperse and rarefy. But if we wait too long, then the plume disperses too far. The density gets too low for the main pulse to properly reheat it into a plasma and generate EUV light. There's a similar time delay in the original two-pulse sequence between the prepulse and the main pulse, which is where you wait for the droplet to expand into a disk. Both delays are microseconds long. So ASML has done this before, but obviously a second microsecond scale delay adds substantial complexity. While doing research, I stumbled across an interesting patent application discussing how this sequence might be done. I've no idea how legitimate it is, but many of the overarching details seem to line up. In the setup listed in this patent, there are cameras measuring the size, position, and shape of the tin droplets after they are hit by the prepulse and rarefaction pulse. Information collected from these cameras are fed back into the computer, which then can determine how to align the lasers. These lasers can move in three orthogonal directions, X, Y, and Z, such that they not only can hit the droplet, but also hit them in the right way, because some plasma recipes demand that the droplet be rotating as well. I reckon that this plume dispersion behavior is essentially random and might be tough to measure. However, research implies that dynamically adjusting the size of the main pulse beam can compensate for the plasma's evolving size. The patent also proposes a three-sequence workflow for bringing an individual machine online. Again, I have no idea if this works, so take it with a grain of salt. The machines are first run at a low-duty cycle, where it only needs to hit a small percentage of the droplets, like less than 1%. So, in the first sequence, the machine begins in low duty with just the third of the three lasers active, the main pulse laser. That laser starts scanning the droplets and calibrating its laser positioning to consistently hit them. After it gets to a certain threshold, then one by one, the other two lasers are brought online and added in the same way. First the pre-pulse laser, and then the rarefaction pulse laser. Now, the EUV machine has learned the positions of the droplets and how to hit them. Next, we need to run the second sequence, where we optimize the amount of EUV light generated from each droplet. We start with the second beam, the rarefaction pulse, turned off, thus leaving just the first and third beams to be adjusted for EUV emission. Once that is done, we then bring the second beam back into the equation. We adjust beams 2 and then 3 to optimize. Again, this is done under low duty cycle conditions, kind of like a warm-up jog before a big run. And then a third and final sequence, where we refine all three lasers' positions for both goals, consistently hitting the targets and maximizing UV energy. This will be done under high duty operating conditions, where pulses are expected to hit 80 to 90% of the droplets. Once that is achieved, the machine is ready to go. So what does this all mean? Achieving a three-pulse structure will potentially require multiple laser sources, precise time control down to the nanosecond level, and high control slash optimization of the pulse's parameters. If ASML manages to pull this off, then it implies as much as a 30 to 50% jump in conversion efficiency, as well as significant improvements in debris generation. And now suddenly, 800 or even 1000 watts looks within reach. This is a big deal. For years, EUV machines were starved for EUV light photons, forcing us to use it only where necessary. Now there is a possible future ahead where that starvation turns into an abundance. The possibility that holds for semiconductor manufacturing are exciting. Assuming they can do it, of course. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.